Hello friends, welcome to Civispedia Current Affairs Digital Library. So today we are going to see four topics. It is Saltwater Crocodile Census, Acer Report, Indira Gandhi and Gandhi Prize in Prelims Perspective and Sedition Law in Mains Perspective. Okay, now let's move on to our first topic, Saltwater Crocodile Census. So why this is in news? Initially, the government has conducted a saltwater or estuarine crocodile census, which is in Bhitarkanika National Park of Kendrapara District, Odisha. So that is there in the news. It is an annual census which is held recently. And for the first time, it has used drones to census those crocodile population. Okay. So what are all the outcomes of this? So what they have said is, this census was not only conducted in Bhitarkanika National Park, it is also conducted in lakes, inlets, nulas and other areas or deltaic regions of Mahanati. So what they have found out is, apart from this Bhitarkanika, Brahmani, Baitarni are also the habitation of this saltwater crocodiles, and their population has been significantly increased after a decade. Okay, they have nearly 1742 individuals as per the census, and they have also sighted 12 albino crocodiles during this census process. So this is the outcome of this project. Okay, now let's see what is the background. So saltwater crocodile population was very less during 1970s. So it was nearly 95 individuals which was available, including the 34 adults. But in 1975, along with United Nations Development Program, FAO, and our Ministry of Environment, has started a crocodile breeding and rearing projects around Bhitarkanika National Park. Okay, then that has increased the population of this saltwater crocodile to a significant amount. Even 9 years back, we have a Guinness Book of World Record that states that the Bhitarkanika National Park holds the largest, world's largest saltwater crocodile of 23 foot long. So this is the thing. And according to this report, India, we have three species of crocodiles. So one is mugger, which is also known as marshy crocodile, saltwater crocodile, also known as estuarine crocodile, gharial or gavial. So it is present in both India as well as Nepal. So they have started a breeding program in 34 places, including West Bengal, Uttar Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh, also in Nepal. So these are the areas they have selected for this breeding centers. Okay, now let's see what are the types of crocodiles available in India. So first one, mugger. So mugger is also known as Crocodilus palustris. So it's a scientific name. So this is a freshwater crocodile, a fish eating crocodile, and it also a social animal. So it lives in a groups. Okay, this mostly prefer the area of marshy lakes, rivers and also the shallow slow moving areas. And the very significant thing about it is, it can also survive in artificial reservoirs and tanks. Okay, according to the status, so it is present from southern part of Iran to Sri Lanka, covering all the Indian Ocean region, okay, Indian subcontinent region. In sites, it is considered to be appendix 1 animal, so which means the export of wild species are banned and mugger. And in IUCN, it is a vulnerable species. So what are all the threats associated with this mugger? So one is habitat destruction, because the lands are converted for agriculture and industrial purposes, and they are also killed by entanglement in the nets and drowning, also killed by fishermen as they consider it to be a competition for the fish resources. And they are also sacrificed in superstitious beliefs, and it can also be used as aphrodisiac, which means it increases the libido effect and addresses the fertility issues. So hence, these are all the threat for this mugger species. Okay, now, so this is the thing. So the area of expanse of mugger species. Okay, now, next one is saltwater crocodile. So saltwater crocodile is known as Crocodilus porosus. It is the largest living reptile in the world and is also the largest riparian predator in the world. Okay, now it is mostly marine species, marine living, but it also prefer to live in environment of shallow brackish rivers, lagoons, even in the deltaic regions. These are the areas of the expanses. Okay, now the largest population is seen in Bhitarkanika, but whereas a small population can also be seen in India-Bangladesh border of Sundarbans. Okay, in IUCN, it is considered to be the least concerned species. And according to sites, what they have said is, it is appendix 1 in most of the countries. Like, the export of wild species is banned, whereas in few countries like Indonesia, Australia and Papua New Guinea, it is in Appendix 2, which means there need to be a permission for exporting this wild species, and there is also a permission for exporting the commercially bred species. So this is the Appendix 1 and Appendix 2. Okay, now next one is, so this is the expanse of this saltwater crocodile. Now next one is gharial. So gharial is the most critically endangered crocodile species in India. So it is also known as Gavialis gangeticus. It is also known as gavial. So it is a fish eating crocodile. It is native to the northern part of our Indian subcontinent. Okay, we can see it is in the northern part of Indian subcontinent. This is critically endangered according to IUCN, and it is also in Appendix 1 of sites. And India also protects the species under Wildlife Protection Act 1972, which is under Schedule 1, which also places the animals like leopard and tigers. Now, the Project Crocodile has also included gharial in this project. Now, it is extincted. Once it was nearly found from all the Indian subcontinent rivers like Indus, Brahmaputra, Ganga and Irrawaddy River, but now it is extincted in Indus, Brahmaputra and Irrawaddy rivers. It is mostly found in Chambal River, Son, Mahanadi River, Gandak and Ram Ganga. So these are the basic expanse of this gharial population. Okay, so this is the area of expanse of gharial. So hence there need to be a better breeding program for developing these species. Okay, now let's move on to our next topic, ASER report. So ASER report, why it is in news? So ASER has conducted its 13th annual survey. So ASER means annual status of education report. So hence it terms, it is an annual report. So this time it has seen about children's schooling status and their basic learning levels. So basic learning levels in reading as well as arithmetic. So this ASER report is facilitated by the Pratham, a non-governmental organization, and apart from other larger surveys, this is different because most of the surveys conduct their surveys in schools, but it is a household based survey. Okay, now ASER 2007, the previous year, it was termed as Beyond Basic Survey, which means they have thought about the 14 to 18 year old adults, so which they wanted to provide a useful and their productive lives in their adult age. That is the prospect of that. In 2018, it has conducted from the age of 3 to 16 years in case of reading and 5 to 16 years in case of arithmetic areas. Okay, now what are the major findings they have discovered? So they have said that there was a major gender divide. Okay, there was a major gender divide in this population, that is among male and female, and there was a steady increase as the children grows older because the reading capabilities are getting declined when they are growing older at the age of class 8 or above. Okay, then what they had said is in schooling levels, the overall enrollment of the school was 2007. Till now, it was 95%. But also, the other thing is, the girls who are not enrolled, it was initially 20% in 2008, but now it has reduced to 13.5%. So these are the basic thing. But the problem here is, the improvement of the skills of children from the lower primary to upper primary are steadily declining. So this is the schooling level program. Okay. Now, apart from this reading, what is this reading they had said? So in reading, in 2008, it was 84.8% for class 8 students who can read a level of class 2. But now it has steadily declined from 74.6% to 72.8%. It shows the lesser amount of skills in children. Then again, arithmetic. So arithmetic has also decreased for a class 8 students who can divide a 3-digit number by a single digit one. So these are also reduced from 44% to 43%. So what is the impact of this arithmetic skills? So what they have said is from 8 to 10 years, the boys and girls average is very meager, less than 1% of differences in arithmetic capability. But when the age increases from 11 to 13 years, the gap of this increases to 2% and above. Then when it is 14 to 16 years, the differences is increasing so much, it's more than 5%. So what are the factors influencing this arithmetic capability? Means the most of the girls are getting into the household responsibilities due to this menstruation issues. Since India being a patriarchal society, so this women need, the girls' children need to have the household responsibilities as well as the menstruation issues, which is stopping them from attending the schools properly. And most of the areas, the rural areas, they have the physical education which is very scarce, and this is not seen in many of the schools. Okay, this is the issue. Then what I had said is the teacher-student attendance, the other highlights. In India, the teacher-student ratio, attendance ratio is equally average for all the areas. Nearly 85% teacher attendance and student attendance is 72%. But about 90% student attendance is seen in Karnataka and Tamil Nadu area. And 90% and above teacher attendance is seen in Jharkhand, Odisha, Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. So this is because of the midday meal schemes and other welfare programs, poverty alleviation programs, which make students and teachers to attend schools properly. The next one is sanitation. Right from the beginning of Right to Education 2010, that we can see a substantial improvement in sanitation, like usable toilets, which has grown to 66.4%. And even the midday meal scheme has increased nearly 80%. Drinking water has also increased to 65%. But this national average hides the variation in many of the areas like Jammu and Kashmir and Northeast, which have less than 50% of usable girls' toilets, usable drinking water supply and usable midday meal scheme. So these are very less in these areas. So what the report has suggested is there must be a strong foundational skill for these children to develop their reading and arithmetic capability to cope up with the upper primary standard. So this is the recommendation of this AZER report. Now, let's move on to our next topic, Indira Gandhi and Gandhi Prize. So we are going to differentiate what is the prize. So first, let's see International Gandhi Peace Prize. So this is an annual prize given by Government of India. Okay, it was start in the year 1995 to commemorate the 125th birth anniversary of Mahatma Gandhi. So this prize is a cash prize with a citation. It is given to both individuals as well as institutions. They must contribute towards socio-economic and political transformation using non-violence or other Gandhian principles. So this is open to all persons nationally or internationally, apart from the caste, creed or sex, anything. So it is open to all. The persons choosing these eminent persons like juries, Prime Minister of India, Leader of Opposition of Lok Sabha, CJI and two eminent persons, they choose the recipient of this award. In 2018, Shiyoshi Sasakawa of Japan has received this International Gandhi Peace Prize for eradicating leprosy in Japan, India as well as the world. Okay, so this is about Gandhi Peace Prize. Next, Indira Gandhi Peace Prize. So Indira Gandhi Peace Prize is also an annual award. It includes cash prize as well as a citation. So this is given by Indira Gandhi Memorial Trust. So this is also given for individuals as well as organizations once they develop international peace, development and new economic order, scientific discoveries for larger human populations, as well as if they increase the scope of freedom. Okay, so here the jury includes the eminent personalities of both international as well as national. Even the past recipients of awards can also be a jury member. In 2018, the Center for Science and Environment has received this Indira Gandhi Peace Prize. So this is for developing the sustainable model in India. So this is the about Indira Gandhi Peace Prize and India Gandhi Peace Prize. Okay, next. Now let's move on to our main topic, sedition law. So what is this sedition law? In recent news, there was the sedition charges in Assam as well as JNU. We have seen in the news. Now what they had said is, in section 124A, there must be a prior sanction from the authorities to arrest or file a charge sheet against an individual. So this has raised so many questions like whether the laws relating to seditions are valid. Is it constitutionally valid? Or the circumstances for invocating a seditions are proper, or whether it should stay in the statute or it must be repealed. So there are so many questions raised against this sedition law. Now let's see how the sedition law evolved. So first, the sedition law in India has started in the pre-independence era of 1870, which introduced Indian Penal Code that incorporated section 124A, which means the sedition law. According to the Privy Council, which is the British court which had said that the accused person must bring or attempt to bring, okay, it must bring or attempt to bring a hatred or contempt, okay, or it must attempt to excite disaffection towards the government. Either even attempting itself causes a sedition. So this is given by Privy Council. But using this Section 124A, the colonial era has crushed most of the national movement. Even it has arrested so many leaders like Surendranath Banerjee, Balagangadhar Tilak, Gandhi, even Annie Besant were arrested by this sedition law. Okay, but after independence, the Constituent Assembly, it has actually passed the judicial scrutiny of constitution. So what they had said is the fundamental rights of citizens must not breach the vilification of government. Hence, there must be a counterbalance of fundamental right as well as vilification of government. Hence, they said that the sedition law must prevail. Okay, but the basic idea about this sedition law was thrown light in Constituent Assembly debate by K.M. Munshi. So, what he had said is the sedition law, which actually strikes the fundamental rights, and it must be eliminated from the statute book. Okay, the constitution makers has also accepted his ideas and they have omitted the word called sedition from the fundamental right 19 to part 2, which means the freedom of speech and expression. So they have deleted that word from the fundamental right. Okay, then apart from that, the Federal Court of India, okay, the Federal Court of India, Justice Maurice Geyer has said that the sedition, it must not be a minister who are wanted to do the wounded vanity to the government. The sedition must incite a disorder in the community and it must be accepted by majority of the population that it has incited violence. Only then it can be considered to be as a sedition. But in 1959, Allahabad High Court has also said that sedition has struck the root of fundamental rights. Hence, it must be considered to be an unconstitutional. But later in 1962, the famous verdict, Supreme Court verdict of Kedarnath versus State of Bihar. So, Supreme Court has adopted the Federal Court judgment, replacing the Privy Council ideas. Like they, what they had said is, whether a word is an ill-performed or pungent or whatever it may be, that word must incite a violence, okay? Incite violence or public disorder. Only then it can be considered to be as a sedition. Hence, this incitement to violence has become an essential ingredient in the sedition law, okay? Then, time and again, Supreme Court reiterated its decisions in 1995, Balwant Singh versus State of Punjab. Okay, what they had said is they applied the Kedarnath case in this Punjab case. During Sikh riots, there were some slogans issued by many people, but that slogan did not incite violence in the Sikh community. Hence, what they had said is it does not amount to sedition. So this was said in 1995 Balwant Singh case. Next, in 2003, Nazir Khan versus State of Delhi, what they had said, again Supreme Court what said is, this fundamental right of an individual also have their own political theories. It doesn't mean that the dissent towards a political party doesn't amount to a incitement of violence or it is not considered to be a sedition. So these are the cases, evolution of the sedition law. Even in 2018, the National Crime Record Bureau had said this, within the period of 2014 to 16, there are 179 cases filed against this seditions. Out of that case, only 18 cases has come up for this trial, and with that only 2 cases was convicted. Okay, so the range of proving the sedition is very tedious in India. So hence it is actually a time consuming as well as an expensive process. Hence it must be reviewed. Okay, then in 2018, Law Commission has also released a paper called Consultation Paper on Sedition to get suggestion from the cross sections whether this sedition law is according to the present time. Is it fulfilling the present scenario? Okay, then the interesting thing is the country which has introduced sedition law into India, which is United Kingdom, has already deleted the sedition section. And even US has sedition law, but it is very narrower compared to India. There are no ground for repealing the sedition law in India. This is actually a major issue. So hence, what we can do to regulate this sedition law. So one is, there must be a effect based examining of cases. That means there must, we have to see the effect of the sedition law rather than a content based, which means it sees the text which are used in slogans or sloganeering. Okay, even we must educate the law enforcement agencies about the Kedarnath case, that incitement to offense, incitement to violence is a case for sedition law. Okay, then penalties of misuse of sedition law must help to regulate this sedition cases, and we must also make this law bailable as well as cognizable. So this can help to regulate this sedition law. The anti-national slogans are not about sedition. Only when a slogan amount like Indian state is a tyrant or Indian state must be overthrown, that can be amounted to a sedition. Not just a slogan or sloganeering amounts to sedition. So this is the basic about sedition law. Okay. So with this, I conclude today's topic. So please like, share and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Thank you.